If you have your Bibles or your phone and you'd like to turn to the passage that we're going to look at today, that is found in Revelations chapter 2, verses 8 to 11. For those of you who've been away on holiday, as I have been as well, we've been talking about the seven churches in Revelations chapter 2 and chapter 3. And last week, Mike led us to the passage that talked about the church in Philadelphia. Now, that's not south of the border. That's another Philadelphia. But he shared with us how God was using that letter to speak to a church in Philadelphia and how that impacted that church. You know, having worked in the third world myself in Africa for 15 years, we see how communications are important. And you know well that when these passages were written, there was no such thing as the internet and everything moved pretty slow. But it's important to remember that these letters were an important part of the ministry of the church. And the Apostle John writes seven letters, and most of them are to make some corrections or some mid-course corrections of churches that were in trouble. You know, I have given my life to the church. I've been in the ministry now for going on 39 years. I wouldn't change my occupation for anything if I had 1,000 lives to live all over again. Really, I mean that. And I've seen the church in various churches. I've served in three large churches, including this one in Canada, and then in several churches over in Africa. And I love the church. I remember when I was in seminary, I had a professor. His name was Dr. Samuel Stays. And this man's heart beat for the Church of Jesus Christ. I took pastoral theology and homiletics and several courses from him. And I can remember one class one morning, cold Regina morning, and he got up and he was talking about the Church of Jesus Christ. And he said to us, he stopped in the middle of his lecture and he said, "Guys, girls, those of you in this class, never forget how much the Lord Jesus Christ loves his church." And then he broke down and sobbed uncontrollably. And I thought, that's a man who knows the heartbeat of God himself. For you see, the church is more than just a building. I was listening to an interview on a sports show the other day by Tiger Williams. He used to play for the Vancouver Canucks, and he was asked in a kind of a satirical way, "What kind of church do you like, Tiger?" And his response was fairly short. He said, "Red brick." And I thought, yeah, that's how some people look at the church, don't they? They look at it as a building that they would never, ever want to go inside because it's kind of mysterious and there's very special people in there that they couldn't relate to. And as I think about churches, I've been in churches and served in churches that have been on a high plateau and going places. I look at the year ahead here, and I think that our church is going to be going through a very euphoric experience as we now enter back into a new facility, a new program, and we're going to be excited about that. But I've also seen churches that were going through hard times where there's a dissension and division, and people leaving the church, and people very disgruntled with the pastor, and all of those things. And there was days when I felt like, what am I doing here? And I would turn to God and say, what is this thing, the church? And how does a person serve year after year after year with an organism that you love deeply but is so imperfect? Well, we're going to look at a church today that was the epitome of a faithful church. For of the seven letters that the Apostle John writes, this is the only church where there is no criticism. Now, that doesn't mean that there probably wasn't some problems there, but they weren't glaring enough for him to stop and point out and say, this is something you need to work on. You know, as I talk to people in our community and I talk to people who are outside the family of faith, I like to ask a question. It's kind of a catch question that it just helps me to know where they're at on their spiritual walk. I'll say to them, what do you think about the church? And they'll stop and say, well, I don't have much to do with that organization, but yeah, I guess it's a good place. And as I look at it, I guess a lot of people ask, why should we even have a church? Now, there's probably some positive reasons that we could respond with. We could say that a place is where spiritual people go. The fact that you're here on a hot July afternoon would tell me that you have some spiritual interest, some desire to take another step and grow with God and to be with God's people. Other people would say, well, it's important to have a church because it's a place to receive teaching, community, and fellowship. One thing that we like to kind of say about Cochrane Alliance Church is that we reach out to our community, but that we are also a community of faith. We have the in, out, and up in our whole arrangement here. Thirdly, we could say that it's important to have a church because that's where passionate followers of Jesus Christ go. It doesn't mean that we can't pursue God, that we can go to a place that doesn't necessarily have a formal structured church. But the Bible teaches us that it's important to come together as God's visible representation, his living organism, or the church. But then sometimes I ask that question to non-believers, and I say, why should we not have the church? And I get kind of some interesting reviews on that question. First of all, some people say to me, well, Pastor, only good people go there, and I'm the furthest thing from good. And I'll go, well, I wouldn't be so sure about that. I work at one of those places, and there's a mixture of good and sometimes not so good, if you know what I mean. And then there'll be other people who will say to me, I could never go to a church because it's full of imperfect people. And the H word comes up often. It's full of hypocrites. I know you've talked to friends who have said that. I see people who go there Sunday morning and they have a permapress smile on their face, and then they go out and live like the devil during the week. They're hypocrites. And I kind of hang my head in shame, and I go, well, if you pursue any group of people of any dimension in this world, you will find hypocrites. That's part of being human. Not to defend it, but to say that there are hypocrites in every crowd. Others, and particularly the millennials that we work with today, are saying this over and over again. The church is okay, but it's now grown to be irrelevant. It has lost touch with the world. It is having trouble keeping up with where the world is going. It is an irrelevant organization. When I look at these questions, I ask myself, what does the Church of Jesus Christ mean to me? Is it just a spiritual club that we go to and we say, I'm a good person because I go to church? You know, it's kind of funny. People will say to me, if they've been away for 3 or 4 weeks, Pastor Larry, I'm sorry I haven't been at church for 3 weeks. And I'll go, let me just take out my phone. Yes, I realize that. We take role here. No, I say just the opposite. I say, no, we don't take a role here, and we don't check you off a list because we want you to be here at this church for your own good, not because you're a better person because you warmed one of these seats, and today you need to warm it, don't you? It's one of those things that we have to ask ourselves often. Today, we come to a church that was passionate about doing church. If you were to write one word across their church, it would be this word, faithful. Or if you were to put it in a short phrase, it would be faithful no matter what. This is the Church of Smyrna. We want to look at this church because I think it gives us an opportunity to look at what a real, genuine, legitimate church with followers of Jesus Christ looks like. When we look at Smyrna, we realize that it is in a setting that was going through real rough times. Let's just look at a few of the historical points of the Church of Smyrna. First of all, the writer is the Apostle John. The Apostle John, when he wrote this passage, this letter, was almost 100 years old. He lived to be one of the oldest of all of the apostles, and he is the only apostle that didn't die of some kind of martyrdom or suspicious causes, if we can put it that way. He died a natural death. The city Smyrna that he was writing this letter to, and he had a passion for all of these churches, and so he was writing these letters. He would probably seal it, give it to a runner, and they would deliver it to the church until he could get there and face-to-face discuss it with them. But this city of Smyrna is a city that is still alive today. It's not called Smyrna. It's called actually Izmir. It's in Turkey. When we had the Alliance Assembly several years ago, Pixie and I had the chance of attending that in Turkey, and we were in a town called Anatoli, which is right near Smyrna, and Smyrna now is called Izmir, and it is a city that has grown very, very cold spiritually. There are only two evangelical churches in that city, and both of them are very small. But Smyrna was in a time back then of intense persecution. And you know, we don't really know much about persecution in the land of Canada, do we? In a few moments, I'm going to share about my living in a country, the country of Guinea, where I worked with a church that had gone through persecution and continued to go through persecution of various sorts while we were there. And it helped me and it helped Pixie to gain a new appreciation for this church of Smyrna. Because we were there and we started looking at this church that was paying a great price for following the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the midst of those dark little communities there in Africa, these people were remaining strong and courageous and paying the price. But as the Apostle Paul was writing to the church in Smyrna, it was a time when there was a very evil dictator, and Mike mentioned this man last week. His name was Domitian, and he was a very, very tyrannical dictator who hated Christians passionately. And so he made some legislation which said, Christianity has been banned. Anyone who follows the Jesus way will have to stand on account for it and is in danger of losing their life and being put to death. And so Domitian put out the order and said that this is what stood. But in that same area was a very brave church father called Polycarp. Polycarp is one of the people in church history who stands out as a firebrand, as a legend in all of the martyrs of the church, for he is one who gave his life under the dictatorship of Domitian. A church father and a martyr, indeed. He was on his tour as kind of the bishop of all of these seven churches, and he landed in Rome, and when he landed there, Domitian laid a trap for him, arrested him, and brought him before a Roman tribunal. Polycarp was unafraid. He was a fearless man of God who passionately loved the church and the Lord Jesus Christ. Domitian said to him, "It is time for you to recant or you will lose your life." And he said, "I can't do that." He said, "I can't do that because I have served the Lord faithfully." In fact, these are the exact words. I'll get them to put them up on the screen for you. He said, "For 86 years I have served Christ, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king who has saved me?" And we are told that the court turned to him again and said, "If you do not recant of Christianity, we will burn you at the stake." He said, "I remain firm." Several days later, he was led to the place where they were preparing a fire where he would be burned at the stake. And again, they asked him, "One last time, Polycarp, this is your chance to give up and renounce your faith and save your life." He said, in a very simple phrase, "I remain a Christian." We are told by those, both secular historians as well as spiritual Christian historians, that as Polycarp was burned at the stake, he prayed and cried out. And legend has it, I don't know how true this is, that as he was actually being burned, that the smell of cooking bread came from that fire. That it was a sign of a broken bread, much like we celebrate when we have communion. Yes, Smyrna was a church that was in big trouble. And to be a Christian in those times, it was a great price. My friends, there are churches around the world this afternoon as we sit here who are paying the same kind of price. They know that if they follow the Lord Jesus Christ, that it could be their life, that they could be persecuted, that they could have suffering, untold tribulation. So let's read those few short verses just as a setting for the discussion. This is what the Apostle John wrote to the church in Smyrna. "To the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these are the words of him who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again." That is the Lord Jesus Christ. "I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know about the slander of those who say they are Jews and they are not, but are a synagogue of Satan instead. Do not be afraid of about what you are to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. But be faithful, even to the point of death, and I will give you your life and your victor's crown. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who is victorious will not be hurt at all by the second death. As we look at the beginning of this passage, and again, Mike referred to this last week, but for those of you who weren't there, a kind of a mysterious phrase that starts off. It says, to the angel of the church in Smyrna write. Who is this angel? Well, I did some research, and several of the commentators said, well, the angel is just that. It was literally a spiritual being that God appointed to look after that church. And one commentator went as far as to say, any church that is an organized group of believers meeting together regularly has an angel that is appointed to them. I thought, well, that's kind of cool. I wonder what the Cochrane Alliance angel looks like. But as I looked a little further, I realized that that same word, eglos, can also be translated more like what is the ethnos of a church, or that is the stuff that makes it a distinctive church. Now, if you look at our church, there are certain things about our church that make it distinctive. We have four values, don't we? We have certain things that we really think are a high priority, that we really think we should do. We have worship, we have outreach, we have community, and we have the proclamation and worship. But other churches have other values. And that is what some people in the Old Testament and the New Testament referred to as the angel, the stuff that makes that church unique. And so the Apostle John is saying to the church in Smyrna, I am writing to what makes you a particularly important church to me, as well as to the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he goes and he says, these are not my words. These are words that are coming through the power of inspiration through me to you as a group of believers who are gathered together. And then he says, I have only come to encourage you. Now, if you look at the next phrases, you kind of go, well, not much of an encouragement when you want to look at it quite bluntly. What does he say? Well, I'm here to tell you that tough times are coming. And I don't think the church in Smyrna needed to be reminded of that. They had already gone through real, real tough times. But he starts by saying, there's certain things that are going to happen to you, but instead of running from them or shying away from them, be the people that you have been in the past. Be faithful to the end and stand for what is right. So, the people there in Smyrna get ready to hear what the Apostle Paul says. And this is the list of things that he gives to them. He says this, you will have tribulation. Now, when we hear that word tribulation ourselves, we go, that's what's great about being a Canadian. We can go to church with freedom and liberty and all of those things. But I don't know how long I'd last if I had to put my life on the line and I was going to go through a time of tribulation. Life for the church in Smyrna was tough. It was difficult. It had challenges. They were constantly looking over their shoulder, wondering when the next of them would be arrested and thrown into prison. They wondered when they would be persecuted and tortured. But the Apostle John said, I have to tell you that persecution is part of the cross that you as a church have been asked to carry. And part of that is poverty. You are going to have poverty. You are going to be persecuted because of your stand for Jesus. When we worked in a little town up in northern Guinea in Concon, we could see why this would be true. It was a town that was 98% Muslim. And when people came to know the Lord, which was extremely rare, they were immediately cut off from being able to buy in the market. They had no chance of getting a job, for part of their punishment was that they were cut off economically. And commentators who have studied the Church of Smyrna said this is probably what was happening there. as people took a stand against Domitian, and they said, we are going to follow Jesus only. They said, well, if you want to have it that way, we won't let you buy. We won't let you do commerce. We'll let you rot economically. But the apostle says, that is the price of being a faithful church. And then he mentions slander. Possibly there were stories that were made up about this church, as are many churches who stand for the truth. He said, there are people there who claim to be Jews, but really they're running a satanic church. And they're calling you a cult. They're saying you do stupid things and weird things because they want to slander you. But he says, remain firm in the truth that we have been teaching you. And then he says, you're going to suffer. There's going to be suffering in general. We don't know what that form will take, but be ready to pay the price and suffer for the Lord Jesus Christ. And then finally in that list, he says, possibly some of you are going to die as martyrs, just like Polycarp did. You know, when a church pays the price for that, they are viewed by God as being a precious jewel. For it's very easy when we're sitting comfortably in a church where we don't have fear of soldiers rushing in and arresting us or putting us in prison for following Jesus. But there are many places in our world today that face that. It's a common, everyday occurrence. When Pixie and I moved up to this little town, the little town of Concon, very strong, hot, dirty little town, 3 mosques in that town, big mosques. And we made friends of many Muslim people in that town. But one of the friends that we made was a man who came to be a Christ follower just before we arrived. His name was Michelle. Michelle was the man that helped Pixie and me kind of learn how to speak Menica. He would come every morning and he would sit in our veranda and teach us how to say Menica words so that we could share the gospel message with the Menica people in that country. And one day he said to me, you know, Pastor Larry, I'm a believer. I came to Jesus Christ because I knew that there was something true in your religion that wasn't true in mine. For in my religion, there is no grace. There is no gift of salvation. And I just couldn't get away from it. I said, Michelle, that's wonderful. And what was the result? He said, the next day, they called a community meeting in the town where we were working. And they came and they took my wife and my 2-year-old son, and I've never seen them to this day. And I looked at him. I felt guilty. I said, Michelle, was it worth it? Was it worth it? And he said, Larry, I tell every person in the Muslim faith, if you're going to follow Jesus, you must first of all be ready to die. A man who, like the church at Smyrna, had realized that suffering to the place where he would lose his own family, he might even die, but it was worth it to follow the Jesus he loved so much. That's the negative side of the Apostle John's quote-unquote encouragement. But as we move down, we see that things get better in his letter to the church there. First of all, we see that there is a hope-filled encouragement that starts in verse 8 there. 2 simple phrases that ring true to a suffering church. The first one in verse 8, simply 3 words. Do not fear. Now, it'd be very easy for us to walk in there to a church like that and say, don't be afraid, God's going to be with you, and then we pack our bags and hop on a plane and fly home, and we don't have to face that every day. But here was a church that knew what was ahead, and the apostle had just outlined what was still coming, and so they knew that it wasn't going to be an easy road to travel down. You see, fear is that which freezes us. It causes us to look inward and down the road and say, I don't really want to put up with that kind of persecution because there may be pain. there may be ostracization, where we are ostracized from others who we want to be with. We may be economically affected, and the list goes on and on. But the Apostle John says to them, "Dear friends, do not be afraid." I did a little study, and as a counselor, I get a lot of people who come in and say, "Larry, I live with anxiety. I have these secret fears that keep welling up in my life." And I'm able, from a spiritual perspective, to say to them, "Do you realize that fear turns us into false prophets?" What do I mean by that? You see, by saying that we fear something, we are looking ahead and saying, "I know what's going to happen," when really only God does. And so rather than using our energy on being afraid, we somehow have to grasp what it is to get hold of that fear, turn them over to God and say, "God, come what may, I am not going to fear. I'm not going to live by fear. I am going to move ahead, knowing that you are there for me." Another thing we learn about fear is that we can either run from it, or we can either run from God, or we can run to him. Fear is that which makes us make a decision. When a fear comes into our life, we can say, "I'm either going to shoulder this fear by myself, or I'm going to go to someone who knows all about fear and how to handle it." It may seem so simple that we trip over it, but from a Christian's point of view, that's what the Apostle Paul was saying. Don't worry about the persecution. Don't fear about the persecution that's coming. Face it when it comes, and God will give you the courage to stand strong. Another thing he says to them is, God uses even the devil's work to bring about his good. Now, some of you are going, "What in the world is that man saying up there?" But look at that passage. He says, some of you are going to be thrown in prison. I'm going to let Satan have his work for a while, and you're going to be thrown in prison for up to 10 days to be paying the price for what it is to follow Jesus. But again, he's saying, you don't need to worry about that, because God comes to the place in his own work and in his own timetable and in his own plan where he says to Satan, "You've had it long enough. Get out of here. Now I will move ahead and I will conquer." And then he leaves a message to them, the second prominent message. He says, be faithful no matter what. Be determined in your heart with God's help that come what may in persecution, that you are going to be faithful. And then he says in the very last part there, there's a reward waiting for you. And if you can get through this stage of life, all of the problems, all of the persecution, all of the suffering included, there is a rich and wonderful reward waiting for you. It says there in that last passage, the second death, which means physical death, will have no power over you. And once you jump from that life, I'm already fitting a crown of reward for you. Isn't that a wonderful promise? You can say a quiet amen if you want. A wonderful promise for all believers, but particularly the church in Smyrna, who were looking with some kind of apprehension, possibly, towards persecution that lay ahead. Well, now we pause and say, that's the church of Smyrna. But how does that relate to me here, Cochrane Alliance Church, in the church in Canada? How does that relate to me? I don't have to worry about that. All I've got to do is make sure that I come to church, and if I'm a good person, pay my tithe, and maybe join a few committees and help out in the church, but I don't really have any fear of suffering or persecution. But you know, I don't think any of us are exempt. None of us are exempt from the message that the apostle left the church in Smyrna. So what does the faithful church in Cochrane, Alberta, Canada, look like? Well, Scripture makes it very clear that geographics don't make a lot of difference. It's where our heart is that really matters. Passionate followers and discipleship makers of Jesus Christ is the first thing that shows what a church that is faithful really looks like. Again, in our country, we know very little about actual persecution. But God is saying to us, I want a church who is passionate about following me, is passionate about reaching out to their community and bringing others into the fold. But more than that, I am looking for people who are willing to take the time to reproduce what they have in the lives of other people who are brand new Christians. That's one of the mandates that we as Cochrane Alliance Church hold very dearly to. Let me ask you a question without possibly meddling here. Could that be said of you? Could that be said of me? Are we passionate followers and disciples makers of Jesus Christ? Or are we able to just settle for the status quo, the ho-hum, of being a good person who goes to church? Maybe we need to look at those churches that daily go through suffering and persecution and say, oh God, give me that same fervor even here in the town that I live in. The second thing of a faithful church is one who takes the Bible as their guide for life. I have to say this afternoon, that our society and even our church communities in certain sectors are beginning to question once again the validity and the power of the inspired word of God. I always say when someone comes with a problem, look first in the word of God and find your wisdom there, for that is the guide for all believers. If it's not there, then find it in some other source. If we are a faithful church, we take this book seriously and say, no matter what comes, this will be our guide. It will be our roadmap for spirituality and where this church is going. And then a faithful church is made up of people who are fearless and unashamed of their faith. I don't know about you, but I've got to be honest this afternoon, this is one that I'm still working on. There are times when I get into a situation and I'm with non-believers and I have a tendency to kind of maybe compromise a bit or kind of gloss things over or kind of fade into the crowd a bit instead of saying, no, this is what I really believe. And quite frankly, I don't care what you think. That's what I believe. It takes courage. It takes someone who is passionate and wants to really, truly follow the Lord to speak up and be heard. How about us as a church? You know, we've been talking as a staff as we go back to our new church. And we are praying earnestly, and we are ourselves as a staff searching our hearts, saying, God, please, 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 in spite of this beautiful edifice that has been constructed, please don't let us just settle for this wonderful, beautiful building. But may we daily give it back to God and say, God, the reason we have built this is not so people would say, wow, that's a pretty fancy church you got there. But that we could use it as a tool to reach a broken, hurting community, the Cochrane community that needs our Lord and Savior. May we be a faithful church who is reaching out to do that. I want to close with a story that I think I will remember as long as I walk the face of this earth. It has two parts to it. One that happened many years ago while Pixie and I were missionaries in Guinea, and one that happened a year and a half ago to the same people. Just after I arrived in Guinea, I was still struggling with my broken French and my very limited Menica. And in Africa, it works a little bit different than it does in Canada. The fact that you have come as a missionary, you're put up on a bit of a pedestal, and they think you can do anything and everything, literally. And one day I was sitting there in my house, and a runner came to the door, and they handed me a letter, and here it came from the district superintendent. And it was a letter saying that there's a pastor's conference happening in a month, and the lead speaker will be our new missionary, Pastor Larry Charter. I'm going, but they didn't ask me. So I went to my colleague, who is an older missionary, and I said, Paul, I got a question here. I've been asked to speak to all of these pastors who are coming into this village, but no one asked me if I could do that, and I'm scared spitless. My French is terrible, my Menica is terrible, and man, I'm not the guy for this job. And he said, "Oh, Larry, get over it. That's just the way it is in Africa." I said, "Get over it? I'm going to be a bumbling fool up there." He said, "Larry, as part of the cost of following Jesus, get off your butt and start writing some messages." Wasn't what I really wanted to hear. I wanted a little bit of a love in there, but I didn't get it. I worked, I'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, I'd write out my messages in English and then translate them back into French. And finally I came up with 3 messages and I was spotted for 3 different sessions there to speak. Packed my Land Cruiser with pastors and we headed way up country to a remote part of the a remote village in the northern part of the country. As we pulled into the village, I could see that this was a massive village. It was in the forest region where there are animist worshipers, and many of them steeped in very deep witchcraft. As I drove in the road, I could see that there were fetishes in all of the fields. And these fetishes are little leather pouches, and inside they have the human remains of people who had been given as human sacrifices. I looked at that and I go, boy, this is what you see on TV. This is what you read in books. As I arrived, I said, "Oh God, if I ever needed you, I need you now. I'm not one who speaks in tongues, but I need you to help me speak in a different kind of tongue here." As I settled into, literally, the chief moved out of his little grass hut, mud walls, cow dung floors. The bed was made out of baked mud, real comfortable, Sealy Posturepedic, I'll tell you. And as I moved into that, I felt so, so scared. "Lord, how can I share with this group of pastors who are going through hard times and difficult situations, difficult villages?" About that time, there was a knock on my door, and here was an elderly man. I'd never met him before. He was starting to get white hair, so I knew he was kind of an elder. And he said, "Pastor Larry, welcome to our pastor's conference. I'd like to talk to you if I could." So we sat down outside our little grass hut, and he said, "Pastor Larry, I just need to kind of give you some information here." He said, "Are you aware of the village that you're in?" I said, "No, I've never been here before." He said, "Well, you need to know this. I'm not trying to frighten you. I just want you to be aware of this. There's only a very small Christian church here who has suffered greatly over the years. But within this village is also the largest witch doctor's school in all of West Africa. The lady that runs this witch doctor's school is an evil woman." And then he put his finger in my face and he said, "And she knows you're coming." Whew, wow, this is what they tell you about, huh? And then he said these words that the Apostle John said to the church in Smyrna. "But Larry, do not be afraid." And then he turned and he said to me, "Are you afraid?" And I said, "Should I be?" He kind of chuckled and he said, "No." And then he said to me in Manica, "Greater is he that is in the world, in us, than he that is in the world. Larry, we don't need to be afraid." He said, "Now let me tell you another story." He said, 33 years ago, I was fresh out of the Bible school, the same Bible school where Pixie and I taught. And he said, "God had called me to be an evangelist, not to be as a pastor, but to go from village to village, just like those old guys used to do." He said, "I've crisscrossed this whole country back and forth as an evangelist. I have more stories than you could ever listen to." But he said, "The very first village that I came to was this village where you're speaking." And you know what, Larry? The same thing happened to me as happened to you just now. One of the elders in the village pulled me aside and said, "Pastor Daniel, do you know anything about this village?" And he said, "Nope, never been here before." "Well, this is the largest witchcraft school in all of West Africa. And the man that runs this witchcraft school knows that you're here and he's out to get you." And he said, "I immediately began to be a little bit nervous. Because," he said, "don't ever kid yourself, Larry. You don't need to be afraid of the devil, but you need to respect the fact that he does have power." And then he said, "I lived to see that night what he was talking about. The old man said to me, "This witch doctor is known for one of the most terrible treatments on Christians of any other group of people in all of our country. He uses killer bees that he prays an incantation over them, and then he sets them loose on people. People come in and pay him money, and he takes these killer bees, and by the power of Satan, he sends them out to attack people that they want to get back at. And rumor has it in the village that he's going to set those killer bees loose on you tonight. And there's thousands of them, and they will sting you and probably completely kill you if he has his way." And then the old man said to him the same thing that Pastor Daniel said to me, "But don't be afraid, you'll be all right." Have you ever been in a beehive before? I don't like bee stings any better than you do. And then Pastor Daniel told me this. He said, that night, you got to understand, in Africa, we never have power. So we have these kerosene lanterns or propane lamps, and they hang them, and they put up tarps at night, and it's just like the old tent meetings. Pastor Daniel said, "I was just starting to preach, and as I was preaching, I was sharing the plan of salvation, because in spite of it being a pastor's conference, all of the village had been invited as well. And because of the rumors that were floating around about these killer bees being let loose, everyone was there to see what would happen. And as he was preaching, he said all of a sudden he could see in the back, through the light of the kerosene lamp, a swarm of bees coming right down the center aisle. He said, my first reaction, Larry, was to say, what do I do now? And he said, it was as if God said to him, just keep preaching and don't be afraid. He said, I had my black Bible and I was preaching like this. And he said, Larry, I'm not exaggerating. When those killer bees came down the aisle, and as soon as they got over the Bible, they dropped like stones, dead as a doornail, all of them. And there was a hush that went across that pagan crowd, and people couldn't believe what had happened. Then he turned to me and he said, Larry, no matter what happens this weekend, I want to assure you that everyone who is going to be here wants to hear the message you have brought from Canada. And that was the night that God released my tongue and let me share from broken French, from a heart that loved those dear people. A year and a half ago, this is the second part of the story, I received word. Pastor Daniel gave his life as a martyr. It was election time in Guinea a year and a half ago. And if any of you have worked in the third world, you know that when elections come around, things can get pretty tense. Pixie and I lived through three of them, with bullets going over our head, and it's not a fun place to be. Some of the government officials came to Pastor Daniel. He was then pastoring a small church not far from where Pixie and I served. They said to him, Pastor Daniel, we want you to get up in your pulpit and tell them that everyone must vote for the government, the incumbent government that was hopefully going back into power. Pastor Daniel said, I can't do that. They said, why? We're not asking you, we're telling you. You will do that or we'll throw you in prison. He said, well, then that's what you're going to have to do, because God has called me to preach the gospel, and I will take no political stance from the pulpit, and I will not be responsible for promoting any government, whoever they would be. They said, you're really serious about that? He said, yes, I am. They said, come with us. They handcuffed him, took him to prison. His family followed later with his food, because there's no food provided in the prisons there. They said, this is just a threat to kind of put out the word to the community, the Christian community, that they better vote for the government or they'll be in trouble. You can come by tomorrow morning and we'll release your dad and husband. The next morning when the family came by, they released his body to them, for he had been murdered by the government forces during the night. When word came back to all of our missionary family who were no longer in Guinea, I wept like a baby. because I thought here was a man who had poured into my own life the fact that we should not fear, that we need to be courageous, suffering servants of Jesus Christ, and that we needed to be faithful no matter what it was that God called us to do. And now Daniel had paid the ultimate price. And I thought, as I pictured in my mind's eye, his cute little round black face with sparkling eyes, every time he talked about Jesus, it radiated from him. And I thought, as long as I live, I'll remember that faithful servant, Pastor Daniel Mato, and the fact that he was willing to be faithful like all of the church in Smyrna, because he knew that following Jesus Christ was an eternal investment and that there were eternal rewards. Dear friends, I am praying that our church will be a church that is passionate about following Jesus Christ. You know, you say, well, we don't ever have to worry about persecution. We've got the Charter of Rights. We've got protections built in. But we never know. Someday God may call our churches to go through persecution. Will we be ready for that? Will I be ready for that? God calls us to faithfulness. He calls us to be people that are unflinching, people that are avoiding and rejecting the temptation to be fearful people, and to follow him with our sights on Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. May he make us like the church at Smyrna. Will you pray with me? Loving Heavenly Father, I have felt an urgency as I have prepared this week to challenge all of us, to challenge myself first of all, but then to challenge all of my people that I love so much in this church to be people who are faithful. People who are faithful in their witness about Jesus Christ. People who are faithful to stand strong and not to really care what people think, but to stand up and say, I am willing to be counted with the people of Jesus Christ. As we read, Lord, in Timothy there where it says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of salvation unto all who believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. O God, make us fearless people. Make us people who are willing to pay the price and to serve you with all of our hearts. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.